Good morning, and thank you for the introduction, and thank you to the Society of Mining Metallurgy Exploration for hosting this event yet again. Dave Kanagi told me this morning that I think in one way, shape, or form, this is the 154th version of this type of annual conference, where we can get industry professionals together to start really looking at how we solve some of the challenges that are faced with us. I will try to be brief since I'm not the main event, but on behalf of Newmont, we are genuinely honored that we've been the main sponsor for this MINEXCHANGE annual conference for the last 3 years running. An opportunity to bring thousands of mining industry professionals together, where we can network, we can talk, and we can learn with each other. We've been thrilled to work closely with SME over the last several years, bringing more people into the community, co-developing professional development, pushing for efficient and responsible practices in an industry that has long needed it, and doing that across exploration, mining, metallurgy, water, and waste throughout the life cycle. For over 100 years, Newmont's worked diligently to manage our assets responsibly and support the local communities that we live and work. Our current portfolio spans 17 operations over 9 countries, each with their own unique challenges that are probably consistent with many that you have in this room. At Newmont, we recognize the role that we play in this industry, that we need to support not just our shareholders, but also the reputation and the progression of the industry itself, so that the stakeholders said can see mining maybe in a little bit of a different light than they have previously, and certainly in one that is a sustainable and necessary industry. We all need to be keenly aware that in this industry, unlike many others, we have a responsibility for the reputation that each of us deliver, that one misstep by one of us and one of our operations will impact all of us. And you can garner trust over many, many years, but you can lose it in a heartbeat. Newmont's indeed on its own transformational journey, but so is our industry. Together, we have the power and responsibility to shape the future and be a catalyst for change. This is why we're so pleased to work with organizations like SME. That really gives us a chance to start to get into the ground level and work for that change that we know that we need. So I challenge everybody to have a great week. You know, meet as many people as you can. It's a great chance to network. It's a great chance to start to learn from your peers. It's a great chance to make new connections that you will carry on for years and years and years. And with that, I'd like to thank SME again. It's an outstanding organization that I've been absolutely blessed to be able to work with over the last 30-odd years of my career. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Mark Levere, the 2023 SME President, and it's been my privilege to serve this year as your President. For our safety share this morning, I'd like to note the emergency procedures here at the Phoenix Convention Center. Should an evacuation become necessary, please immediately leave the building using the nearest exit. Move away from the building using caution when crossing streets and remain outside until directions are received from the security personnel that it's safe to enter. There are several exits visible from the North 120 foyer space. We have planned another great conference this year with more than a very up-to-date number of 6,511 registered delegates in attendance. Our technical program includes 113 sessions, 73 sponsors, and more than 584 exhibiting companies. Before we get started this morning, please be certain to turn off your cell phones. And as I unfortunately learned the other day, that means your Apple Watch 2. It cost me money. Our session today is titled, Energy is Everything. Energy expert Alex Epstein opens the session with a presentation about the need for affordable and reliable energy in the future. and perspectives on how coal and other fossil fuels can continue to provide improved energy delivery systems for developing nations. With nearly a billion people without reliable power and potable water, providing affordable, reliable energy encourages the innovation necessary to support developing countries. A panel discussion follows Alex and covers the state of today's energy grid and the dangers of net zero by 2050. And we're honored to feature on the panel Brad Crabtree, Assistant Secretary for the U.S. Department of Energy's Office of Fossil Energy and Carbon Management, Jimmy Brock, CEO, Consol Energy, Jimmy Staton, President and CEO, Santee Cooper. Following the panel, we will take questions from the audience and then conclude with a lecture from Daniel Connell, Senior Vice President, Consol Innovations, Consol Energy, Inc., and Jackie Fidler, Vice President, Environmental and Sustainability, Consol Energy, Inc. They will speak to us about the continuing role for coal in a sustainable future. And now, please join me in welcoming Alex Epstein. Alex Epstein is a philosopher and energy expert who argues that human flourishing should be guiding principle of energy and environmental progress. He is the author of the new best-selling book, Fossil Future, Why Global Human Flourishing Requires More Oil, Coal, and Natural Gas, Not Less. He is also the creator of EnergyTalkingPoints.com, a source of powerful, well-referenced talking points on energy, environmental, and climate issues. Alex, welcome to the podium.
What is the most popular political idea in the world today? Louder. It's so interesting. Everyone always says climate change. Climate change, it's supposed to be a physical phenomenon, not a political idea. I think it's related. So political idea, I mean an idea about what the government should do, what the government should compel us to do. And so this is an idea that most major corporations agree with. It's an idea that leading financial institutions promote. And it's an idea that virtually every government in the world says is a good thing, which is hard to get unanimous consensus on. So what's the most popular political idea in the world today? Sustainability, I think it's close, but there's a specific variant of what people call sustainability. There you go. Somebody said net zero. Yes, so net zero, carbon neutral. And the way I really think of it is the rapid elimination of fossil fuels. Like in one way or another, it's the rapid elimination of fossil fuels. You can ask in the question period about carbon capture. I don't think there's any possibility that we're going to use as much fossil fuel as we use today and then capture all the CO2 cheaply or for free or for profit in the next several decades. So in practice, net zero means the rapid elimination of fossil fuels. So show of hands, how many of you are in the fossil fuel industry? That's it. All right, a bunch of you. So yeah, this is an existential issue for you, but I also think it's an existential issue for the world. And so what I want to share with you is why I think this idea is the exact opposite of the truth. Some people will say, it's a little too fast. You know, we should be net zero by 2060. My view is actually we should be using more fossil fuels by 2050. I think the world would be a better place if we're using more fossil fuels by 2050. All right, I got 8 claps there. I'm gonna try to get more by the end. So it's a real obstacle though that net zero is the number one political idea in the world today. And I think there's a reason for this. There's a plausibility to it, although I think it's ultimately very wrong. And the plausibility is that when, you know, the leading source of energy in the world is fossil fuels, and when we burn those fossil fuels, they have some side effects, and the main side effect people are concerned with these days is that they put more greenhouse gases, particularly CO2, in the atmosphere, and those gases, I think most scientists believe, and I agree with, have a warming effect on the atmosphere. And so there's a question about what to do about that. And it's like a legitimate question, but it's interesting everyone has converged on net zero. Let's just get rid of fossil fuels, which I think is totally the wrong answer. But it's a plausible thing. And I think there's one sign of hope here is that people are starting to see that there's something off with the net zero approach. And in particular, what they're seeing is that a lot of the promises that the net zero people made are not coming true. Because one of the promises that they made was they said, well, if we don't, you know, if we rapidly eliminate fossil fuels, or we try to, we're gonna have more energy and it's gonna be green and it's gonna be abundant, so we won't have any problems. And yet what people are starting to see is with just a little bit of movement in the net zero direction, we're having all sorts of energy problems. In the United States, we have tons of grid problems right now. We have electric outages or shortages, I should say, around the country, all over the place, where we didn't used to have them. I live in California, so I'm a particular casualty of this. You know, in 2020, we had statewide blackouts that we definitely were not warned of. Texas, same thing. So we're seeing that, and it really seems to be related to this net zero policy. It really seems to be related to suddenly these electricity shortages started occurring when we started shutting down fossil fuel plants. People are starting to see, wait, that correlation may actually be causal. And then we're seeing in Europe, when Putin invades Ukraine in particular, Europe thought it was totally fine by banning fracking and by opposing fossil fuels and by doing nothing to import fossil fuels from free countries. And yet it saw, no, we don't have nearly enough fossil fuel. And then finally, I think the most blatant example of something going wrong with net zero that hasn't been publicized, but is in the poorer parts of the world, as others are buying up fossil fuels when we're short of them, the poorer countries are being left in the lurch. For example, a place like Bangladesh, which depends on natural gas, when Europe builds up the price of natural gas, they have power outages. So we're seeing that net zero is really not working, and it's important to note that we are nowhere near even going net zero. We haven't even reduced the level of fossil fuel use. Net zero wants to rapidly eliminate it. We haven't even reduced it. All we've done is we've slowed the growth of it. And even by slowing the growth of it, we're having a global energy crisis. So people are waking up, and I think there's a really promising, that's a really promising intellectual development. But I don't think it's enough. I think there are two things that are needed to really make the most of this opportunity. And so one is explaining, where is net zero going wrong? What's wrong with this idea? How did all of these really smart people who told us this was definitely the right idea, how have they led us into a direction that seems to be going quite badly? And then the next question is, what should we actually do? Often people are too critical of what others are doing but don't have a positive idea themselves. What is the positive of what we should do? And so I'm gonna talk about that today. And if you want the shorthand answer, the problem with net zero is that it ignores the unique and enormous benefits of fossil fuels, and the path forward is energy freedom, not preferences for fossil fuels or anything else, but the freedom of all sources of energy to be produced and consumed. So that's gonna be the basic idea. And this leads me to sort of how I got in this thing, because sometimes people think, oh, you know, you are the world's biggest advocate of fossil fuels, you know, you must have grown up in a pro-fossil fuel area. So I grew up in a place called Chevy Chase, Maryland, the DC area, which is very anti-fossil fuels. I was at Duke for 4 years, I learned nothing positive about fossil fuels. Then sometimes people think, oh, it must be a family thing, like the Epstein family has oil money or something like this. So no one in my family is in energy at all, and I'm not also related to Jeffrey Epstein, for anyone who is always asking me that. I'm Epstein, just so you can get the difference. And then, of course, the thing is, people think, oh, you must have been paid off by the fossil fuel industry. So as a young man, you know, the fossil fuel industry found you and said, this is going to be a good advocate. So they groomed you and put on golden handcuffs. And so I didn't even know anyone in the fossil fuel industry when I came up with all of my basic ideas. So that's not how I come to this at all. How I come to this is actually from a background that people think is the most useless thing to think about energy and environmental and climate issues, but I think is actually the most important thing. So to just give you a sense of the different opinions on this, I'll show you. This is a clip of me and my former Senator Barbara Boxer when I was testifying, and she tried to explain why I had no business being there, and I tried to explain why she needed a philosopher.
Mr. Epstein, are you a scientist?
No, philosopher.
You're a philosopher?
Yes.
Okay. Well, this is the Environment and Public Works Committee. I think it's interesting we have a philosopher here talking about an issue.
It's to teach you how to think more clearly. So that actually wasn't scripted, but it was, and that's, so philosophy, one of the key things philosophy studies is thinking methods. And most people just think, but they don't think about how they think. And one of the things philosophy is supposed to teach you is step back. How are we thinking about this issue? What is the right way to think about this issue? And when we have a situation like today's where net zero, the prevailing conclusion that we have is going really wrong, it's worth thinking about what's the right way to think about this. Because if you think about the right way to think about it, it can help you understand what's gone wrong with net zero, and then also what is the right policy going forward. And today, in my work in general, I advocate at the core a very simple thinking method that's really interesting because nobody ever disagrees with it, and yet almost none of our leading thinkers actually follow it. And it's a very simple idea. It's the same idea you would use when deciding whether to take a prescription drug and which one to take. And it's the idea of carefully weighing the benefits and the side effects. So if I said to you, hey, when choosing a prescription drug, should we carefully weigh the benefits and the side effects of this drug and then the alternatives, would anyone say no? You would all say yes. Would anyone say no? Let's just look at the benefits and ignore the side effects, right? You could die if you did that. Or let's just look at the side effects but ignore the benefits. You could also die by not taking a life-saving drug. So everyone, and no one would say, well, we should overstate the benefits or understate the benefits or overstate the side effects or understate the side effects. Everyone would agree you need to carefully weigh the benefits and the side effects. And yet, when it comes to fossil fuels and their CO2 emissions, almost nobody does this. And this is probably the most important slide today, because I think this is the key to thinking about the issue, talking about the issue, and understanding what's going wrong with the issue. Because everyone agrees you should carefully weigh benefits and side effects, but they don't do it with regard to fossil fuels. And there are three elements of this. So when we're thinking about fossil fuels and their emissions, their climate-related emissions, there are three things that we need to do. And nobody has ever challenged any of this. So if anyone wants to challenge it today, just bring it up in the Q&A and you'll get first priority. So the first thing is, if we're thinking about fossil fuels and fossil fuels going forward, we have to factor in what are the broad benefits of using fossil fuels going forward. So what are the benefits that we'll get from using fossil fuels that if we rapidly eliminate fossil fuels, we'll use? And one of the things that really struck me when I started learning about this issue was that there's a blatant one that almost nobody talks about, which is the benefits to food. Food is obviously of fundamental importance to human life. And if you look at how food is produced today, we depend overwhelmingly on oil-powered machinery, like diesel-powered machinery, that allows, for example, the one farmer using a modern combine harvester to do the work that used to take 1,000 farmers using manual labor to do. So these amazing machines, and we have no equivalent with non-oil, basically. And then the other thing is, we use fertilizer derived from natural gas, and we have no near-term replacement for that at all. So yet fossil fuels are so essential to food, I often call them the food of food. And yet when we hear the media and different experts so-called talk about fossil fuels and food, they almost never talk about the benefits of fossil fuels to food, but they talk all the time about the negative climate side effects. So for example, there's a guy, he was in the news recently, this guy Michael Mann, who's a very famous climate scientist and activist who in my view unfortunately won some money for somebody criticizing him on the internet recently. Anyway, he's one of the leading voices on this issue, and he's considered arguably our leading expert on what to do about fossil fuels. And yet he has a whole book about fossil fuels and climate, and he talks a lot about fossil fuels and food, but only about how different kinds of climate changes could negatively affect food, which that's a fine thing to explore. But he doesn't even talk once about diesel-powered machinery. He doesn't even talk once about natural gas fertilizer. Now, how can you possibly think about an issue intelligently if you're only thinking about the benefits? Rather, if you're not thinking about the benefits and you're only thinking about the negative side effects. This is why, this is the core reason why net zero is so disastrous, because everyone is pretending that fossil fuels don't really have any benefits, and so let's just focus on the side effects we don't like, and let's get rid of fossil fuels. So we need to factor in the broad benefits, yet most of our leading so-called experts don't. The second thing that is even more ignored is when we're thinking about the benefits of fossil fuels, we have to factor in what I call the climate mastery benefits of fossil fuels. So when we think about fossil fuels and climate, everyone tells us only think about negatives. Fossil fuels, it's only a question of how negative they are, not whether they're negative. But if you think about what we do with fossil fuels, one of the main things we do with fossil fuels is we protect ourselves from climate danger. Think about, of course, heating and cooling. I mean, imagine this area without fossil fueled cooling. And also, this is a great place for nuclear, so nuclear cooling as well. And think about, but it's not just heating and cooling, although those are very undervalued. The leading cause of climate disaster death historically is drought. So drought kills people by causing famine. It used to be the leading climate-related killer, but we use fossil fuels for things like irrigation, for things like moving crops from one place to another. And guess what? Thanks to that and other innovations, we've reduced the death rate from drought by over a factor of 100 in the last 100 years. So a person today is less than 1 in 100 likely to die of a drought than they used to be. And yet, our leaders don't talk at all about these climate-related benefits, these climate mastery benefits of fossil fuels. They only talk about negatives. But you can't think this way. And this is at the highest levels. So for example, the leading organization in the world on climate is called the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, IPCC. So whenever you hear the scientists say X, that means the IPCC, or in particularly its PR people, say X. And this is considered the most prestigious organization in the world. And yet, if you look at the IPCC, they have thousands of pages of reports and they don't once mention the climate mastery benefits of fossil fuels. So think about this. Imagine you had like the International Polio Organization and they were putting together a report and they didn't once mention that, oh, by the way, we have a polio vaccine and we're safer from polio than ever. You'd think this is a totally disreputable organization. You can't trust them on polio if they're ignoring the polio vaccine. And yet they're ignoring fossil fuels, which in many ways are the climate vaccine. They keep us a lot safer from climate. So again, everyone will agree that we need to factor in these benefits, general benefits, broad benefits, and climate mastery benefits, and yet almost nobody is doing it. And this is why the thinking is so bad, but it's also a big opportunity, because when you're talking to people, if you can frame it as, hey, will you agree that we should carefully look at the benefits and side effects of fossil fuels, including we should look at the climate-related benefits, almost everyone will say yes. And that's really powerful. If you can reframe the way they think about it, then they can be open to the facts. And I'm about to share a lot of facts with you. But the first thing is to reframe the thinking. If you don't reframe the thinking, they'll be super biased and they won't even listen to the facts. So the final thing we need to do to carefully weigh the benefits and side effects of fossil fuels with climate is, of course, we need to look at the climate side effects. So when we put more CO2 and other greenhouse gases in the atmosphere, what does that do to things like temperature and storms and floods and sea levels? We need to look at all of that, but we need to do it in two ways, two respects that are not often done. So we need to be even-handed, which means we need to look not just at negative effects, but positive effects. Here's a poll. How many of you have ever seen a headline that thanked climate change for a nice day or good weather? I never have. And yet, is it really possible, if we're changing the global climate system, which I think to some extent we are, that it's never leading to anything good, that it's all bad? Like that doesn't, and particularly if you think about, well, one of the things, the most uncontroversial thing it does, it has a certain warming effect on Earth. Well, a lot of people in a lot of places die of cold. So isn't it good in some ways? We'll see. It's actually a lot more die of cold than of heat. And then also we know from just, you know, basic biology class, CO2 is plant food. Aren't there a lot of good consequences for plant growth? It doesn't mean the positives of those outweigh the negatives, but it means we need to consider them. And if people aren't considering them, that means that they are biased. So we need to be even-handed, not biased about the climate side effects. And then the other thing is we need to be precise. So there's a huge tendency that's very well known for anyone who knows anything about climate science. For the public speakers, or what I call them, the designated experts about climate, to wildly exaggerate what any kind of scientist actually says. So for example, Al Gore has the most influential piece of work ever on the subject called An Inconvenient Truth. In that movie, he portrays sea level rises as imminently going to rise 20 feet. Like, you feel like it's three decades away. But if you look at the literature, these projections are, you know, over thousands of years. And in fact, we've experienced 1 foot of sea level rise in the last century. You know, that's the current rate that we're at, is 1 foot a century. And, you know, extreme projections we'll see are 3 feet a century. So we need to factor in the broad benefits, factor in the climate mastery benefits, and then factor in the climate side effects, but with even-handedness and precision. And the reason I'm spending the most time on this is because once you get this way of thinking, it'll totally change how you think about it. And once you get this way of thinking, you can also talk to people about it in a dramatically different way. And a lot of the success I've had persuading people is I reframe the conversation around carefully weighing the benefits and the side effects versus just jumping into the conversation with 18 facts that they're not gonna be able to process. So with that in mind, I wanna share with you some of the key facts for each of these categories. And I just wanna say again, none of the net zero advocates has refuted this methodology, and yet none follow it. They almost always ignore most of the broad benefits of fossil fuels, totally ignore the climate mastery benefits, and then they just focus on negatives of CO2, and then they exaggerate them. That's how they get to net zero. So let's talk about factoring in the broad benefits, and I wanna focus in particular on what I think are the myths that are most plausible that make people think that fossil fuels are bad and unnecessary. And the first one, and this is in a sense the most plausible one, the only real explanation anyone can give for why are you denying the benefits of fossil fuels is they say there are no real benefits to fossil fuels because it can be rapidly replaced by mostly solar and wind. And this is just, I believe, totally false, and I think we'll see from the facts this is obviously false. So I think the truth is that fossil fuels are currently, that's inarguably, but they're currently, and then for decades, they'll remain uniquely cost-effective and scalable. And the title of this session is Energy is Everything, but I would say it's really cost-effective energy is everything. So what do I mean by cost-effective? Three dimensions: affordability, so how much can a typical person afford? Reliability for people in coal, I think this one you'll be very sensitive to. Reliability, is it available when we need it, in the quantity we need it? Quick question, what percentage of the time are solar and wind available in exactly the quantity needed? We heard 5, 2, 20, oh, those are all wrong. What percentage of the time is it available in exactly the quantity needed? Zero, yeah. So it's just it doesn't mean you can't use them, but it is a challenge if you're never, your base case is you're never available in the way that's needed. Okay, so affordable, reliable, and then versatile, this is also ignored too much, which is the ability to power every type of machine. This is where oil is, you know, the most unique, I think, where we're talking about airplanes and cargo ships and a lot of different kinds of heavy industry. And so versatility is really important. Also, industrial heat is a really important thing that usually burning fossil fuels is more cost effective for. So affordable, reliable, and versatile. And then the final dimension is scalability. So it's cost effective, affordable, reliable, and versatile for billions of people in thousands of places. And my argument is fossil fuels are not only this way today, but there's really no argument that they won't remain uniquely cost effective for decades to come. So they do have unique benefits. So we'll just go through a few myths. Fossil fuels are being rapidly replaced in an energy transition to solar and wind. No. Fossil fuel uses 80% of the world's energy, and it is still growing despite literally the most popular political idea in the world is to destroy fossil fuels. Yet it's still growing. And despite huge, massive solar and wind favoritism, and despite aggressive competition. So there's clearly something special about fossil fuels. Now, people deny this. And they'll say, well, no, actually, fossil fuel use will soon rapidly decline, even if that hasn't happened yet, because countries know that green energy will be cheaper and they're investing accordingly. But if you look at the countries that care most about cheap energy, they're pro-fossil fuels. Above all, China, the country that cares the most about cheap energy, is using mostly coal to produce green technology, and they have 300, so think about this, 300 new coal plants in the pipeline, each designed to last 40 plus years. So there's a reason for that. There's something that's uniquely cost effective. They're the leaders in solar and wind. If they could, they would use solar and wind to produce solar and wind. But they're using mostly coal, and they have good reasons for that. Now, the next thing you'll hear is, okay, but solar and wind, they're growing fast by outcompeting fossil fuels with superior economics. Now, this is half true, but it's a half truth. They're growing fast on a relative basis. So year over year, they're increasing by significant percentage. But they're using government preferences, enormous preferences. And so they're mandated, they're subsidized, and the biggest one that's not recognized, I think this audience will recognize it more than most, is that they pay no penalty for unreliability. So they're allowed to sell unreliable electricity to the grid for the same price as reliable electricity, which would never work in any other industry. Like, you can't have a rental car industry that sells you a car that works a third of the time and a car that works all the time for the same price, and yet that's considered acceptable in electricity. So they're massively preferred, and then we have massive punishments by government of fossil fuels. So investment is punished, production is punished, refining is punished, transportation is punished, fossil fuel use is punished, like shutting down coal plants, for example. So another one is, okay, but they're now cheaper. You'll hear studies that say Lazard is showing they're now cheaper to use, you know, fossil fuels, to use solar and wind rather than fossil fuels. And this is false in two ways. One is that for the vast majority of the world's needs, solar and wind aren't even competing because they're not providing the kind of transportation energy that's usable. And they're also not really competitive with a lot of industrial and residential heat, which we do more efficiently by burning fossil fuels directly. So only a fifth of the world's energy today is electricity. So one is they're not even competing. It's not even an apples to apples comparison. But then the other thing is that even for electricity, they are dramatically more expensive if you factor in the full cost. So there's this argument that, well, they're getting so cheap that they're just, everything's gonna be electrified because solar and wind is so cheap. But if you look at the full cost of them, they're enormously expensive because you have to pay for 24/7 life support. So this shows the Texas freeze. I think it captures what happens is, you know, the week before the Texas freeze, you have a lot of solar and wind. And so people say, hey, let's just double the solar and wind and it'll give us all our electricity. But then you face the reality that at any given time, solar and wind can go near zero. And so at one point they crater to less than 1% of their supposed capacity, which is really, I call it fantasy, because it's not a real, capacity means you can do it, not that you hope you can do it. So they're at 1% of fantasy. And that, what does that mean? If you can go near zero at any given time, what percentage backup or life support do you need? You need 100. So what happens is to have true reliability, you need to build close to two grids. You need to have a reliable grid and an unreliable grid. This is why places like Germany that try to maintain reliability have such high electricity prices, because there's so much infrastructure duplication. What happens in places like California and Texas is we play reliability chicken, which is what the US as a whole is doing. So we try to get away with, we want to shut down as many reliable power plants as we can, and then we just have to hope. We hope the sun shines enough, the wind blows enough, doesn't get too hot, doesn't get too cold. And that is a losing strategy, praying for good weather as the basis of your electricity policy, but it's increasingly our strategy. A final myth here, and there's a lot more, by the way. I'm gonna give you some instructions for how to get this deck and a bunch of other resources. I have a whole bunch of other myths that I address, but just the final one to address today is that the reliable alternatives to fossil fuels, such as nuclear and geothermal, can rapidly replace fossil fuels. This is plausible, it's more plausible, but if you look at the trajectory of these industries, where they are, geothermal is really in its infancy in terms of any kind of scalable potential. Nuclear has a lot of potential, but we can see it's just been flatlining for decades, I believe, because the government is so irrationally hostile to it. And I'm working very hard to change those policies, but the nuclear industry is so gutted, we are not talking about any kind of near-term replacement for fossil fuels for electricity, let alone the other forms of energy. All right, so that's kind of the most myths. The other issues are more straightforward, but the summary is that fossil fuels are, and for the foreseeable future, will remain uniquely cost-effective and scalable. And what this means is that if we have energy freedom, which is the positive policy I advocate, so we're free to use fossil fuels and everything else, we can have global cost-effective energy. But if we go net zero, we will have very little energy. And so then the question is, how much does that matter? And I argue it's life and death for the entire globe. So the myth we hear, sometimes when people admit, hey, solar and wind, they're making energy more expensive, they can't really replace fossil fuels, but they say we should do it anyway. Because the cost of energy, that doesn't matter nearly as much as CO2 emissions. CO2 emissions affect the livability of the Earth. Who cares about the cost of energy in that context? So AOC, for example, said the world is gonna end in 12 years if we don't address climate change, and your biggest issue is how are we gonna pay for it? Like, who cares about the cost of energy when the planet is at stake? But actually, she's got it exactly wrong. And in chapter 4 of my book, Fossil Future, I talk about this at length. Actually, how cost-effective energy is determines whether and to what extent the Earth is livable. Because absent cost-effective energy, we live in a manual labor world, in a world that naturally has very few available resources and has a lot of danger, like climate used to be a leading killer before we tamed it. So if you're in a world without cost-effective energy, you're just using manual labor, you can't use machines, that is a terrible world to live in. That's a world where the average life expectancy is 30. So it's exactly wrong. We need cost-effective energy to take our naturally deficient in resources planet and our naturally dangerous planet and make it abundant and safe. The world AOC grew up in that she thinks is natural is incredibly unnatural. It's the product of cost-effective energy. Now, people will deny this. They'll say, no. The reason the Earth is so livable now is not cost-effective energy. It's things like medical care, sanitation, scientific progress, technological progress. They'll say, like, look, yeah, it's, you know, we had sewer systems and we have medical care. That's what causes us to live long, not fossil fuels. And this is like a quarter truth. It's true that those things are essential. Without those, we could not live the way that we do. But fossil fuels are fundamental to all of those. All of those fields to work need massive amounts of machines doing work for us, which those depend on cost-effective energy. They also need enormous amounts of free time that's freed up from us working in the field. That depends on cost-effective energy, particularly in the realm of farming and heating and the basic necessities of life, so we don't all have to be farmers anymore. And then finally, the materials that these fields use. All of these fields use petroleum products in one way or another, usually derived from oil and gas, although theoretically you can get a lot of them from coal as well. So, fossil fuels are, they're uniquely cost-effective, and that makes the Earth a place that's livable for billions of people. As I call it, it's a place where human beings can flourish. They can live lives that are long, healthy, opportunity filled. And without cost-effective energy, they can't on a large scale. And without fossil fuels, we don't have cost-effective energy. And then the final thing people will say is, well, okay, we can still eliminate a lot of fossil fuel use. It won't be that bad because we can save a lot of energy via efficiency. And this is a ridiculously ignorant argument, but people do make it. If you look at the number of people in the world who are in energy poverty, who use very little energy, it's just staggering. And so we need vastly more energy. There's no amount of efficiency gain that's gonna change the fact that the world is drastically energy deprived and needs much more energy. So we have a third of the world using wood and animal dung for heating and cooking. We have 3 billion people using less electricity than a typical American refrigerator. And you can see the wood and dung here. Like, this is people who are using wood and dung for heating and cooking and using very little energy. So what we have is, we look at the benefits. Fossil fuels are a near-term irreplaceable source. Remember, they're uniquely cost-effective and scalable of the cost-effective energy humans need to flourish. So that is that's the overall idea about the broad benefits. And so the implications are that if we have energy freedom, billions more people will have the opportunity to flourish on this otherwise naturally inhospitable planet, And if we have net zero, the world is gonna be a terrible place to live. Billions of energy-starved people will plunge into poverty and early death. So in fact, AOC and others think like we face a climate emergency, that'll make the world unlivable. No, their policy, their climate policy would make the world unlivable. That's the actual emergency that we should be scared of. And so then let's talk about climate. But once you really recognize the benefits of fossil fuels and how unique they are, it's pretty easy to think about climate. Because what you recognize is that contrary to this myth that we're more endangered than ever by climate because of fossil fuel CO2 emissions, we have empirical data that this is false. Because we can tally how many people are dying from climate-related disasters like storms and floods, extreme heat, et cetera. And what we see is those deaths are going down massively. They've gone down by 98% over the last century as we've been using more fossil fuels, putting more CO2 in the atmosphere. Now, why is this? Well, because whatever negatives there have been about putting more CO2 in the atmosphere, they've been overwhelmed by the, what I call the climate mastery benefits of fossil fuels that I mentioned earlier. So our ability to heat and cool, to build infrastructure, to do irrigation, to do crop transport, those matter far more than any climate changes. So you can think of it as our climate mastery far outpaces any new climate challenges. And as long as that's true, you have nothing to worry about. Now, there's a bunch of other myths about sort of climate mastery related stuff, which again are in the appendix and you'll get them in the slide deck. But the argument, the other argument you're starting to hear because people are recognizing, oh, the deaths are down. So say even if the deaths are down, well, the climate related damages are way up. So we're losing so much money, we're just gonna become bankrupted by climate change. But if you actually look at the data, adjusted for GDP, so you adjust by how much our productivity is increasing, climate damages are flat around the world. And this is despite massive government incentives for people to live in dangerous areas and give them flood insurance and all this stuff that encourages people to incur more climate-related damage than they otherwise would. So what we see is the climate mastery benefits of fossil fuels are enormous, and they're far greater than any negatives of fossil fuels so far. So what that means is if we have energy freedom, we're gonna keep getting better at mastering climate. We're gonna be able to protect ourselves from more and more types of climate danger. Whereas if we have net zero, people think net zero makes you safe from climate. No, because it neuters you climate-wise. It makes you climate impotent. You can't do anything to deal with the naturally dangerous climate. Net zero is the worst thing that can happen for climate danger. And so then let's look at the only argument people can make at this point is, no matter what, they have to admit that if I'm right about these assumptions, that net zero will ruin the world. The only thing they can argue is that it'll ruin the world even more to keep using fossil fuels, because despite the fact that we're safer than ever from climate today, somehow the next amount of CO2 emissions are gonna ruin everything. So even though so far it's been amazing, it's just gonna be terrible in the future. There's something about the science that says it's gonna be terrible in the future. Whereas in reality, the people who say it's gonna be terrible in the future, they never admit that it's amazing in the present. So I never take any predictions about the future from somebody who denies the present. Because if they can't predict the present, how can I trust them to predict the future? Predicting the future is hard. Knowing what the present is a lot easier. It's if you look at sort of these different climate-related claims, you see that mainstream climate science, which I think has some exaggerations, but you see that it is totally incompatible with net zero if you factor in the benefits of fossil fuels, and it's totally compatible with energy freedom. So you'll hear, okay, warming is ominous because heat-related death is already such a serious problem, and so if it gets hotter, we can't afford that. But in reality, Earth is already 1 degree Celsius warmer, and yet still far more people die of cold than of heat, even in India. Every continent people live on, more people die of cold than of heat. So that means for the foreseeable future, warming will save more lives than it takes if the warming is evenly distributed. Now people think, oh, it must be distributed. It's gonna hurt us because it's gonna be mostly in hot areas. Just Phoenix is just gonna become an inferno is the idea. But actually, if you look at the mainstream view, so this is Joe Biden's climate.gov here, it's that the mainstream view is warming will be concentrated in colder places, so northern latitudes, colder times, nighttime, and then colder seasons, winter. So this is good news because it means the warming will be even more benign. Now people think, okay, well, even if it's okay so far, what's gonna happen is the CO2 is gonna go exponential. So it warms like this and then it's just gonna go exponential. But if you look at all the mainstream science and all the models, the greenhouse effect is what's called a diminishing effect. So as you put more CO2 in the atmosphere, it warms, but it warms less. It has less and less warming power. You get diminishing returns on your warming. And so what you see in every climate model, even the ones I think are exaggerated, they all show warming leveling off over time, which means that you're not gonna be able to overheat the planet. So then the only other thing they can claim is that, well, you know, we're gonna have some, it's not the warming that's the problem, but it's gonna be sea levels or storms. But if you look at sea levels, well, the extreme projections are just 3 feet in 100 years. And we can deal with that pretty easily, as evidenced by the fact that we already have 100 million people who live below high tide sea levels. This is very slow, even in their extreme estimates. And then the final one that's plausible is the storms are just gonna get so bad. They're just gonna destroy everything. But if you look at the mainstream storm projections, they're saying things like hurricanes will get less frequent and then more intense, but between 1% and 10%. So this is climate impact, but this is not climate catastrophe. So just the final thing, and then we'll have our panel, is You know, the overall idea here is that if we continue to use fossil fuels, we will have an impact on climate. So it's not to, quote, deny climate impact or climate change, but it's a level of warming and other changes that we can master and flourish with just as we've done so far, which means if we have energy freedom, CO2 levels will rise for the foreseeable future, and life will continue to get better and better, just as has been happening already. If we try to go net zero, CO2 levels will still rise. It'll be more slowly, but billions of lives will be ruined, including endangered by climate. Now, one final thing that's really interesting about this issue, which is that actually in the long term, energy freedom policies are more likely to lead to long-term emissions reductions, because what they do is if you have a free, wealthy society, that increases your chances of coming up with an alternative that's truly cost-effective and scalable. I think nuclear is the most promising here for various kinds of reasons. But you need to be a wealthy and free society to do that. If you live in a really impoverished society where everyone is miserable and they're trying to scrape by because they followed these insane net zero policies, you're definitely not going to get a lot of innovation in that realm. And so the only moral and practical way to reduce global emissions is long-term. You can't do it short-term without ruining a bunch of lives, and even that won't work because China and Russia and India won't follow. The only way to approach it is long-term through liberating innovation, not through punishing America or punishing anyone else for that matter. So that's why we're not seeing China, India get off fossil fuels, and they won't until there's something truly superior. So if you care about emissions, focus on making something superior. Don't try to force everyone into not using the superior thing today. So the conclusion is, you know, we talk about cost-effective energy as everything, and energy freedom is the answer. We need to think about this issue, you know, with all the technologies carefully weighing the benefits and the side effects. And if we do, we see that net zero is a terrible idea, not just because it's led to bad results, but because it's failing to recognize the unique benefits of fossil fuels. That's why it leads to such bad results. Energy freedom, on the other hand, will give billions more people the energy they need to flourish, and it will unleash truly cost-effective alternatives. I think it's just the most obvious thing in the world once you think about the issue this way, but the key is thinking about the issue this way. So I hope you take from this today, and you can see this QR code, and Michelle, my chief of staff, Michelle, can you stand up just so everyone can flag you down? She can also give you I Love Fossil Fuels pins if you want. So. Remember what she looks like. And she passed out a bunch of these in the back. Kind of the thing I would highly recommend, if you like the thinking method here and you like the facts here, and also you want to get the deck, is just scan that QR code, put in your email address, because if you do that, you're going to get basically limitless access to what's called energy talking points, which is a resource that makes every single point I made today and thousands more, and will just make your life incredibly easy in terms of persuading people and thinking about the issues. So the number one thing today is think about the issue the right way in terms of benefits and side effects, and then be armed with the facts. So my goal today was to introduce you to that, and hopefully you take advantage of all these free resources and you become just incredibly effective at persuading people and allow, and so that you can actually do more good in the world instead of going net zero. So I hope you can help me fight for energy freedom, and look forward to any questions anyone has. Thank you. Now I think we're just doing the panel right now, right? Okay, so I got a lot of questions for these guys. Okay, so let me put my questions down. So one thing that came up in my remarks was that I have an existential concern about the state of the grid, which probably come out more in this discussion. But I'm particularly excited to have this panel because we have people who know a lot about the grid, are very intimately involved in the grid in various ways. And so I have some topics I want to cover. And I want to have it so that I often see panels and, you know, different people talk about different things. In this case, we have experts, and I want to get each expert's view on all of these things, and then we'll see if there's disagreement within them or with me, then we'll sort of explore it. And can someone update the time here so I make sure that we don't go long? And then, let's just go from there. So the first thing I want to ask all of you is, how concerned are you about the state of the grid today and its trajectory over the next decade? You want to go first? Oh, sorry, and introduce yourself to the audience.
Okay. Yeah, Brad Crabtree, Assistant Secretary of Fossil Energy and Carbon Management, DOE. So reliability is fundamental. Number of power companies represented in the room, you have a legal obligation to serve. Increasingly, our economy relies on 24/7 dispatchable power, including some of the most strategic sectors of our economy. And you made the point about industry and manufacturing requires large volumes of 24/7 power. And there's another reason beyond just all of the needs and benefits of modern society and our economy. If we want to accomplish the environmental goals that we've set for ourselves, if we fail on reliability, then we lose public and policymaker support from day one. Maybe just point out some of the things that we're working on in the Department of Energy and the Office of Fossil Energy and Carbon Management that relate to this directly, is investing in the development and commercialization of technologies that provide 24/7 low and zero carbon dispatchable power. You mentioned carbon capture. We can get to this. I'm a lot more optimistic than you are.
Okay, yeah.
And that applies to coal, natural gas, and biomass, sometimes both together. And we had the first commercial scale retrofit of a coal plant about 10 years ago in Saskatchewan, Boundary Dam. Then Petranova near Houston was serial number two. And we just announced funding for serial number three, which will be in my state of North Dakota, the Tundra Project, a full-scale commercial retrofit of a coal unit, putting $2.5 billion into six commercial-scale retrofits, two coal, two natural gas, and two industrial processes. I would also note that Calpine, which is the largest merchant power producer with natural gas in the United States, received the awards for the two commercial-scale retrofits of natural gas power plants. Those will be serial numbers one and two in the world. But what's important, as the largest merchant generator in the United States, is they have a very stepwise plan to accomplish reductions of half of their emissions from their entire fleet within about a decade's time. I would also note that there are other pathways, for example, hydrogen, either produced electrolytically or with natural gas or biomass with carbon capture, that can provide for 24/7 dispatchable power.
So the core question is, I want to talk about carbon capture near the end, but maybe we could go into a little bit now.
Yeah, but you're quite pessimistic about some of the options.
That's true. Okay, but I just want to know from you though, but the sort of most straightforward question is, how concerned are you? So, like, because I would say, well, if you look at the trajectory, you know, we have, what, 1,000 gigawatts of dispatchable power. If you look at the plans, we're supposed to shut down about, according to the coal industry, you look at the numbers, 20% of that's supposed to be shut down by 2030, according to the Biden administration. To me, that's terrifying when we're already having shortages. So the fact that people are investigating sort of carbon capture on a small scale, that can be nice.
No, but that's my point. We're more than investigating it, we're deploying it.
But you're deploying it on a scale of that magnitude?
Well, but that's, when you're talking about large scale capital equipment, mm-hmm. that's how you deploy it.
Is what?
As you start with projects, you demonstrate them at commercial scale, you build investor and market confidence, and that's why we have a company like Calpine that's moving forward with a stepwise plan.
Right, but if you look at what your colleague Michael Regan is doing, I mean, not your department, but Michael Regan is doing at the EPA, they're trying to shut down 20% of our reliable capacity in the next 6 years. So this is, I'm saying this scale is irrelevant for that,
it
for
is
countering
not irrelevant
that.
Because if you look at the nature of technology transition, take shale gas and hydraulic fracturing. Uh-huh. You know, that was developed in the same research development demonstration process with industry. And in the late 2000s, it was deployed commercially. And within a decade, it transformed human prospects with respect to energy, as I'm sure you will agree. We have the capacity to, I actually think that what you presented here was not technology optimism, it was technology pessimism, and it was narrow. It was trying to create sort of a parody of the argument between fossil fuels and renewables when there are multiple pathways to provide 24/7 dispatchable power. So I'm very much talking about this, and we have the time, because if you look at the EPA rule, it only applies to coal-fired power plants in the case of coal. If they are to remain running after 2040, then they have to retrofit by 2030. That's 6 years, and later on we can talk about it, but for the first time in US history, we have the most comprehensive framework of federal funding, financing, incentives to help industry deploy these technologies, and we have, as a result of that, 200 publicly announced carbon management projects in the United States, 25 of which are in the power sector. So the idea that we can't accomplish this and we have to throw up our hands
No, it's not throw up our hands. Okay.
Well, but you did throw up your hands multiple times because you basically said we shouldn't solve the problem.
I understand you got to defend this administration's policy.
I'm not defending the Biden administration. I've worked 20 years on
this. Okay, let's just look at the basic numbers here. So again, you're referring to one specific nuance of a rule. If you look at the coal industry announcements, the announcements of retiring, I'll send you the link, reliable power generation. Again, we're supposed to go from 1,000 gigawatts to 800 by the year 2030. You are talking about stuff that requires, that's on a small scale, that requires an enormous amount of funding. It doesn't scale like shale gas does at all. It's totally different mechanics. And if you look at, let's just look at what the IRA says. The IRA says we get $150 to put CO2 underground. We have $150 a ton for carbon, no, 85. Sorry, 85, sorry, I didn't, I'll explain the math. It's $85 a ton, right? You burn one ton of coal, you basically get $150 for the CO2. Like 1.75 tons of CO2 generated. So we're paying people for $30 worth of coal. We're paying them $150 to put it underground. This is a massive subsidy. This is not something that's scaling quickly in any kind of market way. Sorry, I gotta go on to the others, but we can talk more about it. So again, we have a very optimistic view of the grid. What's your view of the grid?
I'm quite concerned about the grid, particularly the near-term implications of what we're experiencing. We are seeing, by the way, I'm Jimmy Staton, I'm president and CEO at Santee Cooper. We serve about 2 million South Carolinians with electricity. Directly, we serve another 200,000, and we serve about 200,000 water customers in the low country of South Carolina. And what we're experiencing, and we're seeing in a lot of areas, is just mammoth growth. We're seeing significant growth in data centers, and the opportunities that those data centers are going to bring are huge. We're seeing reindustrialization, particularly in the southeast of the country. We are also seeing the transformation or the electrification of the transport market, along with the heating market. And so that is creating incredible growth. And that, just to give you an example for us, we haven't really experienced much in the way of growth over the last 15 or 20 years. Between now and the end of this decade, I expect to see 40% electric growth in South Carolina on the Santee Cooper system. So that growth is coming quickly, and it's scary to me, quite frankly. In addition to that, permitting of any energy resource right now is challenging. I put out an RFP for solar 3 years ago. We don't have 1 megawatt of that solar that has been placed yet. And in that time, the cost of solar has gone up by about 100%. On top of that, natural gas plant takes about 10 years to finally get permitted and put in place. And so in every area that I'm seeing, and we're seeing it, the same thing on the transmission side. Our transmission business, we need to expand it to make it more robust, to live in this new universe that we are trying to create. But it takes 10 years to build a transmission line, effectively anywhere in the country. So that is a problem. And then, Alex, as you mentioned, we're seeing folks close down coal plants around the country. We had announced at Santee Cooper that we were gonna close a coal plant in 2029, 1,200 megawatts. We've pulled that back. And in fact, I won't give out a time frame by which we will close the coal plant. Because my concern in the near term is it takes 2 years to get a data center put in place. And it takes me 5 to 10 years to get something that can generate the capacity for that data center put in place. And so I am very concerned about the grid. We saw it. We saw it December of 2022. South Carolina, and I'm sorry to say this, I've only been at Santee Cooper for 2 years, but we had the first set of rolling blackouts we've ever experienced as a company. Because we had one of our facilities went down. The southeast was incredibly tight. And so we were absolutely, we were challenged. And if you saw the press at the time, everything in the Southeast was challenged. North Carolina, South Carolina, into the Georgia area. And so I'm concerned about the integrity of the grid in the near term. And finally, if you combine that with, and I appreciate Brad's comments about the work that they are doing and the money that the government is investing, because I think those will pay long-term benefits. But in the short term, I don't see those things bringing the value to the table that will enable us to meet these growing needs as we work our way through this energy transition. So I'm concerned about it. We're doing everything we can do at Santee Cooper to move as quickly as we can to ensure that we've got adequate resources to meet the growing needs of the state.
Thank you. Jimmy?
Hi, Jimmy Brock, CEO of CONSOL Energy. I agree with Jimmy. I am very concerned about the grid, and I also believe everyone in the room should be very concerned about it. And we're losing some of the grid reliability because of some known reasons. One is we're replacing dispatchable generation far faster, rapidly retiring these before replacement generation is ready. So I believe in the future there could be an all of the above approach, but I'd like to think everyone seems to want to think about 10 years out. I think we need to think more about present and more about the short term. I mean, as Alex mentioned, I know there's 70,000 megawatts of coal-fired generation have announced retirements between now and 2030. It's not that far off, and I don't think that we can build the transmission lines to replace that in that short amount of time. So if we want to enjoy what we have today, and FERC and a lot of these organizations, grid operators, have the very same concerns, they have warned us about rolling blackouts. And if we want to have the electricity on demand, as many of us here in America are spoiled by, we just flip a switch and it's here, we have to be concerned about the grid. And we have to speak up about it. We have to make sure that dispatchable generation is replaced with equal dispatchable generation. So it can't be wind and solar that's only going to perform 2% in high peak demands. Now, someday they may, but they're certainly not here yet. And I'm really an all the above person. I believe that for the grid to be reliable as we need it to be, we need to have an all of the above approach. We need all these energy. But we're moving far too fast. So I have huge concerns today that, you know, the grid is not reliable, and that's what it needs to be. The grid operators need to make sure that they look at all of the attributes of reliability, fuel security, the things that have stored on the ground, such as coal, that can be there in high demand and has great flexibility of what's needed on the demand. So it's flexibility. It's time. I'm more concerned about time it takes to replace the dispatchable generation that we have and to build out the transmission lines. And I'll just give you an example of that. To reach the goals by 2026 to keep the grid reliable as we like, it's estimated that between 1,400 and 10,000 miles of transmission lines will need to be built, high-grade transmission lines. In 2022, they built 675 miles. And in 2023, January through November, we've built 275 miles. So it's a massive undertaking. And we sat here today and enjoy all of the fruits of fossil fuels and energy on demand. So to me, I have a real concern. CONSOL Energy is doing a lot of innovations and things around about having available grid. And the reason that's important, if we're going to grow as the projection state we are in electrical demand, we're going to need the transmissions, we're going to need the dispatchable energy to be able to provide that electricity for those manufacturers that want to come in, to heat our homes, to cool our houses, to do all the things that are basic human needs that we have here in the U.S.
So one point that came up with a bunch of you was the difficulty of building things. And I think this adds to my fear about the trajectory of the grid, because we're shutting down things and it's almost impossible to build things quickly. I mean, I think of it as China, they can build a subway station in 9 hours. We can't build a yoga studio in 9 months. in this country. And I think it's worth thinking about why that is, because I think it's very related to why people don't like fossil fuels. So if you notice with fossil fuels, one interesting thing is most of the people who are against fossil fuels are also against nuclear, and they're also hostile to hydro. And why is that? And the argument I make in Fossil Future is a lot of the motivation behind this movement is a belief that human impact is bad, and they don't like any kind of impact, so hydro impacts. We shouldn't dam things, and even nuclear, it's wrong to impact things in this way. But you're also seeing this anti-impact manifest itself in delays of solar and wind, because it's anti-mining often, and anti-building things, anti-laying transmission lines. I think that there's the modern green energy movement. I mean, there are people like Brad who are really pro-energy, but a lot of the modern green energy movement is a ruse, because it's really the green part of it is a movement that's against human impact and that opposes it at every turn and makes it hard to build everything. And when you have that hostility, what you find is that you're inhibiting fossil fuels, but you're also inhibiting everything else. And I think one fundamental thing we need is we need a pro-development, pro-human movement that's not pro any particular technology, but that's pro-energy freedom. I think that's one big thing we're missing. I will say, though, that one of the tricks that the green energy movement has is what I think Brad called me technologically pessimistic, and the Greens try to portray themselves as technologically optimistic. I don't agree with that at all. To be truly technologically optimistic is to be pro-freedom and to want all the technologies to be able to compete. What is actually advocated by the green energy movement is picking and choosing certain things, often the things with the least promise, like somehow relying on all unreliable solar and wind, and then saying, hey, don't you believe in innovation? Let's make it happen, and by the way, you're making it impossible to development. Like, that's just falsely reassuring us that fossil fuels, getting rid of them, will be okay. That's not technological optimism at all. And economically, and the most important thing is economic, not technological. Technology serves economics. Ultimately, we want a lot of energy for everyone. The fact that you can do something in a lab, and if the government funds stuff in a lab, but it makes it impossible for people to actually do things on a large scale in the economy, is bad. And this is gonna be a great thing for you to talk about. Right now, many people, including me, would argue the grid doesn't properly value reliability. So I argued, for example, that we pay, you know, the grid basically we have to pay more in effect for solar and wind than for reliable forms of electricity. So how do you think the grid should value reliability? I'm asking you, I understand. You can give me your opinions later, but I want to know you first.
So I'm totally supportive of rules and policies.
You got to use the mic.
Sorry.
I'm totally supportive of rules and policies that place greater value, whether it's market rules at the ISO level, capacity, payments, there's a whole range of mechanisms, mm-hmm. Mostly controlled, some by FERC, Federal Energy Regulatory Commission. In fact, considerably more could be done by FERC, but also at the regional level in the power markets, the ISOs, and of course, state regulatory commissions. And they should all be placing greater value on technologies that provide low and zero carbon resources, 24/7 dispatchable. And if you are investing in those technologies, whether it's nuclear, geothermal, carbon capture on coal, carbon capture on natural gas, you name it, you should be able to earn a rate of return that will, that's basically recognizes and rewards the services that provides to the grid. And we need to have a much more concentrated effort in this country. I also agree that if we're to solve the climate challenge, then we have to build things. We have to build them comprehensively. Respectfully, I think you misdiagnosed the challenge. It's actually larger than you suggest it is. If only it were just grassroots environmental organizations and national environmental organizations opposing development, we'd have a challenge on our hands. But it's, yes, in some parts of the country, it is those groups opposing fossil energy-related projects. But I have a ranch in South Central North Dakota. We have three wind farms on our ridge. My neighbors, as you might imagine, don't want to see another wind farm. It's one of the most conservative places in the Midwest, but I was back there in August, and they are organizing now to oppose a CO2 pipeline. And so this is a phenomenon that is not limited to Democrats or the left or environmental NGOs. This is a grassroots phenomenon that crosses the entire political spectrum. You have conservative landowners and county officials in Louisiana asserting that CO2 storage is dangerous. Well, I'm here to tell you it's not dangerous, it's quite benign. But that is not coming from the left. There is also opposition from the left. So I just think we need to be real sober and realistic about the challenges ahead of us, because we have to do a lot better job of showing local communities and stakeholders of all political stripes that development of energy projects and infrastructure is in their interests.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, I agree the NIMBY stuff is also a very big issue. Jimmy?
The markets, the organized markets we have currently in the country are fantastic for driving down the cost of energy. We, as an industry, we've not done a great job of being able to explain, though, there's a huge difference between the cost of energy, which on any given day, you should drive down to the absolute lowest cost that you can, provide as many options to your customers as you possibly can. But it's on those peak days, those challenging days, when you have to have capacity there, that our markets fail. We have 3-year capacity markets in essentially all of the organized markets in the United States. That is not long enough for people to make long-term decisions, to make long-term investments in the industry. And so they're not being compensated. And so what have we found has happened? We saw it in Texas. We saw it in the Midwest. The only thing that's being built right now are renewable resources to drive down the cost of energy. We've got to find a different way to value capacity. And part of the problem is we've got that, it's really trifurcated markets, because you've got energy market, you've got a capacity market that doesn't work, and then you have states that are concerned about capacity that run, that have their own IRPs, and they try to enforce new capacity into the market, and it has a challenge of being connected to those same RTOs, because they're not, it's not necessarily driving down the cost of energy. So it is a, it's a, it's a major problem for us in the Southeast. The way that we deal with it is we haven't created an RTO. We value capacity. We've got the states down there interested in building capacity as quickly as we can. And we value that by essentially socializing the cost of capacity, which is what I think we need to do more of across the country.
Go for it.
Grid operators need to first identify all, not just a few, of the reliability attributes. For an example, everyone knows that fuel security is a valuable attribute, and the market doesn't favorably do any justice when it comes to that. So for an example, one of the most fuel securities you can have is that fuel on site when needed. So to Jimmy's point, dispatchable fuel that's there. Take coal for an example. Coal can be stored, 2-3 months of supplies can be stored at the site when needed. Whereas natural gas and some of the others, you're totally dependent upon pipelines to deliver the source to you, or other things that could go in the way of that as well. So in my opinion, I think coal is villainized there. They're not really on the open free market. They do not get the fuel attributes that they should get credit for having that fuel on site, on demand, when needed. And as I said before, it can be fluctuate to demand, but it can be stored on site, and the market does not value that at all, in my opinion.
My next question is policy, and try to be quick about this one, but policy wish list. So 3 policies that could dramatically transform the grid for the better, and I'll have Brad go first.
So I'm gonna just take the privilege of going a little bit beyond the grid.
Okay.
First and foremost, and this builds nicely on what we just discussed, we urgently need permitting reform. And so, you know, sometimes, and I'll be brief about this, it is important. Sometimes you make progress on policy when everybody's losing and one side isn't winning. And so whether you look at it from an industry perspective, like you need more capacity, you need to bring projects online, the failure to get permits hurts you. If you are in a climate advocate and you're looking at the infrastructure bill and the Inflation Reduction Act and all these policies to support clean energy, and you can't build projects, then you're missing that opportunity for deployment. So this is starting a conversation. It won't happen in an election year, most likely, but this is starting a first serious conversation in a generation about permitting reform. Second, critical minerals development. We are dangerously dependent as a country, reliant on China, but not just China, for critical minerals and rare earth elements. Yes, this is about our clean energy and industrial economy, and especially the rare earths that we need for those technologies, but it's also about our national security. And so we have to have a robust effort that enabling new mining, both from a permitting standpoint, but advanced technologies to produce our own resources at home, but also refining capacity. And then also getting minerals from wastes and unconventional feedstocks like mine coal, coal waste, mine tailings, a whole range of things. And then finally, support for procurement. And what I mean by that is if you, and we don't have time to go into the details, but if you look at the $62 billion in energy and climate investments from the infrastructure bill over 5 years, the federal financing that's available in that legislation, and then the tax credits in the Inflation Reduction Act, the United States now has the most robust policy framework in the world to incentivize private capital to flow into projects, okay? But what we don't have is government support to stimulate demand in new markets. And it's really hard in the industry that some of these gentlemen and others in the room represent, where you have capital that costs, in some cases, billions of dollars for a mine or a facility. And then you're going to take that risk, and you don't know whether someone's going to pay that extra margin for that product. And in the near term, the government can play that role of covering that incremental cost, and there's a lot of ways to do that. It's actually not expensive, because when you take the cost of zero carbon electricity or a zero carbon product produced by industry in the context of cement or steel or a finished project, it's actually a tiny part of the overall cost. But in a commodity market, it's a big deal, and government can help close that gap, and that will help folks in the business, whether you need to deliver power with a lower carbon footprint or carbon-free cement, you can invest with the understanding that there's going to be some market demand going forward.
A national energy policy. We cannot continue to try to modify the grid within four-year sprints that go in one direction, and then 4 years later, we end up going in a different direction. We have to have something that is a consistent guidepost for the industry, for us to be able to make the kinds of investments to change the transmission infrastructure, bring in new generation of all types in order to be able to serve the growing needs of the country. Permit reform, I absolutely agree with. We can't operate when it takes, when loads can land nearly a decade sooner than what we can deliver on those. And then the last thing I would say is, let's be honest about the pace that this world can actually change, that we can actually move the grid in a way that keeps it reliable, affordable, and resilient.
First, we need to be realistic and make sure the pace of the grid transition doesn't get out of control. Speed will kill us. This will allow time to build a better, more reliable grid based on technologies that are under development but may not be ready at this particular time. Second, EPA rules should not drive our energy policy or our electricity supply. As a nation, we can develop policies that improve the environment without causing reliability problems or making electricity unaffordable. And third, I wrote these down because I wanted to make sure I remember them. Third, we need to do three simple things. Before dispatchable electricity sources are allowed to retire, one, replacement generating capacity should be built and in operation, still in the ground. Two, the replacement capacity should have at least the same capacity value and other reliability attributes as the retiring capacity. And third, any transmission that is needed to accommodate the replacement capacity should be built, not merely planned or under construction. We've seen this play out already to whereas, you know, we've had one development like these coal-fired plant retirements. If you look, you've seen a lot of them back up on those, you know, backdate them, more years they're going to run. Jimmy just spoke about that. And the reason they're doing that is to make sure that they can supply their customers. Again, I think the transition is, and that's why we started our Not So Fast campaign, we truly believe that it's at an accelerated pace that cannot maintain the grid today or the electricity need to flourish or to have industrial growth.
All right. I'm curious, not all of you need to answer this one. but quickly, what is your take on geologic hydrogen and blending hydrogen into the fuel supply for natural gas-fired power plants? Any of you guys want to talk about that?
Dollar funding.
Well, on the hydrogen turbines for power plants, that's in process. There's already turbines that are commercially rated that are in the market, but we are funding continued research and development to improve the technology, both pure hydrogen as well as hydrogen blends. It's not the toughest R&D challenge. It's metallurgy. Obviously, you're talking about a lot higher heat and some other characteristics of hydrogen with metals. What was the other part? Was
geologic hydrogen and then blending hydrogen to
so
fuel supply.
I personally know less about geologic hydrogen, but my colleagues who are working on it at the Department of Energy are pretty excited because we think an industry thinks the resource is bigger than we would have anticipated. So that could accelerate the build out of a hydrogen economy if you can actually take hydrogen from the earth and not also have to build out the systems to produce it as well.
I think there's an opportunity here for hydrogen to play a major role potentially in the generation of electricity as we go forward. But again, we're going to have to be open. We're going to have to let the market, in my view, make the decisions about how best to do that. If we have requirements that it's going to have to be green hydrogen, then I'm not sure that that's going to work. I don't think there's enough water that we're gonna be able to manage that. And so, but if you will let the market determine how best to bring that hydrogen to the table, so for instance, if we wanted blue hydrogen, what are we gonna do with the carbon? I think we might be able to manage that carbon. In fact, we're a lot of investment in that space right now. So again, I think there's a possibility. I am a little concerned about it because the large scale nature of the amount of hydrogen that we would need, we would have to see those prices come down fairly dramatically as we move through this process. So I think it's a possibility, but like many of the things we've talked about today, I'm afraid it's a 15 to 20 year outlook before we actually see it make a dent in the energy infrastructure here.
Yeah, I think it's one of the exciting things that's out there, but again, it's the timing issue. You know, it's not going to replace any of the grid that we have today because it's several years out. We've been approached about it actually, and some of it is fairly exciting because there's, you know, theory out there that you could take a coal-fired plant that is shut down and you could make a hydrogen source there at the site, possibly even using coal or waste coal in that manner. So we're kind of excited about to see the new development, but I haven't quite figured out yet how they're going to transport it and get it to the site. So I think there's a lot of unknowns about hydrogen, but again, using an all-above approach, I think we should value it and let free markets take it where it takes it.
Yeah, so I have a similar view of just, you know, my approach to, as I said, is energy freedom. So with CO2, it's like liberating, getting all the obstacles out of the way so different things can pursue their potential. I try not to be too prejudiced about what exactly the potential is. What I'm very prejudiced about is committing to restrictions on the thing that works and promising that a hypothetical thing will work. We're seeing that fail already, and that's a way to commit suicide in the future. All right, I want to make sure to get in my final question, then we may get into some others. Also, again, Michelle, can you stand up? Sorry. Just get your I Love Fossil Fuels pins from her. She can also help you get energy talking points. And if you have the QR codes, scan them so that you can get the resources. All right, so this is the most topical for me. The prevailing political goal guiding energy policy today is net zero by 2050. And I know it can be hard to take a stance on this view, but I'm curious on your view of this goal. Is it a good goal, a dangerous goal, or somewhere in between? Brad.
I think it's a good goal. First of all, it's not a policy, and it's not just political, as the question characterized. It's a metric, and it's a metric to which we can hold ourselves accountable. I would say it's very challenging to get to net zero by 2050. I would also suggest to everyone in the room that I think challenging net zero in the sense of contending with the climate science behind it has not served industry well. I moved back to my own state of North Dakota in 1997, and I remember Basin Electric was funding the Greening Earth Society, and every week in my email inbox I get an article. I remember one was how more CO2 in the atmosphere increases tomatoes and other vegetable production. And I understand, as someone from North Dakota with a coal industry and an oil and gas industry and the job space and the pride with which the people have and they bring to that work, I understand the sense of threat that people feel to their livelihoods. But we are losing an entire generation. In fact, we've lost two generations of young people around the world by not embracing this challenge, being optimistic about the technologies. I don't disagree with any of the concerns that my colleagues on the panel have raised about reliability, but basically rejecting a net zero framework means that we're not willing to tackle the problem. I think you can be in favor of energy abundance, you can be optimistic about technology, and still get to net zero. In fact, one of my friends and colleagues, Vicky Hall, the CEO of Occidental Petroleum, would very much disagree with your characterization of net zero. She thinks it's exactly where a large oil company should be, and she thinks hydrocarbons are part of net zero. And it's about decarbonizing the molecule. And there are lots of pathways to do that. Does that mean that oil and gas production in 2050 will be at the same level it is today? No, it may be less, but the value obtained from that oil and gas production could be substantially greater, and the job space could be as well. So I think we need to embrace this as a challenge, and as much as possible, well, I'll leave it there.
Yeah, So I don't know if this came, I'll try to make this come across in my talk. Like, the key is net zero is based on, by 2050, is based on horrifically bad thinking. That's fossil fuel benefit denial, climate mastery benefit denial, and the distortion of climate science. So it's not about denying any negative climate impact. It's about actually embracing science, but also embracing economic reality. And I do think that's a message that can win people over. And just saying, I agree with net zero because people who claim that climate science leads to it, that's totally illogical. And you're doing yourselves a disservice if you pretend that your industry doesn't have unique benefits that the world needs for the foreseeable future, and that policies to get rid of those benefits, and that would get rid of those benefits by destroying them before there's any reliable replacement in a world that needs far more energy, like, that is not a winning thing. So it's not about just burying your head in the sand, not engaging climate science, or capitulating to net zero. It's about a new pro-freedom, pro-human path forward.
I think as an aspiration, it's a laudable, I think it's an absolutely laudable goal to attempt to achieve, but to set it as an absolute goal scares me a little bit. I mean, the only thing I know is between now and 2050, I will no longer be the CEO at Santee Cooper. And so while there may be that tempt to just, hey, I can lock in my successors, no problem, I'm reluctant to do that. I've not suggested doing that. What I do know is between now and 2035, Santee Cooper is going to reduce our emissions by 55%. And after that, I'm uncertain. I believe that technology will advance. I really, truly do. I think we will see new technologies come to the table that may enable us to accelerate beyond that. But I can't see that path right now. So what I'm afraid of, by setting it as a hard goal for any organization, will you do anything to make it happen? Will you sacrifice affordability? Will you sacrifice reliability in order to make that happen? That's my only concern about setting it as a goal. I think it's a wonderful aspiration.
Jimmy?
I think for us, it's somewhere in the middle to dangerous. So let me talk about the dangerous part first. If you look, in 2012, we had 300,000 megawatts of coal-fired generation in the US. At the end of last year, we had 180,000 megawatts of coal-fired generation. Now, some of those were shut down for economic reasons and other things, but it doesn't matter. The fact is, that's what we have remaining today. So when I look at, you know, the fast pace that we're trying to do this, this is where I think it's very dangerous. For an example, we could very easily lose our competitive advantage. The critical minerals that's needed for this transition, China today has 80 to 90% of the market. If we continue to have an unreliable grid, increase our cost of electricity, it's only going to give them another advantage. The other side of it is, you know, the White House announced that they expect the demand for critical minerals to increase by 500% for this energy transition. Where are we going to get them? I mean, it takes
you know, 10 to 15 years to get, depending upon the type, to get these mines permitted in place and up and operating. Again, I think the transition pace that they're on doesn't allow time for that. And then the last thing is, you know, like Brad, I'm excited about the technology that can come forward, but where this becomes dangerous is, what do we lose in the meantime? Why are we not thinking about what we have? And even in the short term, you know, plans have been announced. If we lose 40 to 60% of our coal-fired generation here in the U.S., I do not see how the grid is going to function as it is today. And to me, it's a real danger of moving too fast and not really, to Alex's point very early, not really taking in the account of the unintended consequences that Russian will get us to. I mean, think about Europe. You know, Europe shut all their coal.
We got to wrap up. Can you give one or two more sentences?
I was just going to really quick talk about Europe when they shut down their coal-fired generation. You know, when Russia shut off the gas supply to them, they fired those back up and they were able to do them. Here in the U.S., we get extremely anxious to demolish those coal-fired plants. So we may not have the opportunity to come back to those. So let's use all the technology and innovations out there. Let's get it right. Let's have a transition in a timely manner that every American can enjoy the way of life we have today, and we're energy independent ourselves.
So I think all of you are too nice to net zero. Just say a couple final sentences and then we'll thank everyone. If energy is everything, why aren't we focused on making priority number one, expanding the availability of energy? Let's have global energy abundance by 2050. Let's have global human flourishing by 2050. That matters a hell of a lot more than how much CO2 is in the atmosphere, because with energy, you can deal with just about any amount of CO2 in the atmosphere. And without energy, it doesn't matter how much CO2 is in the atmosphere, because life sucks. So instead of allowing it to be framed as, when exactly do we get rid of CO2 emissions, let's frame it as, energy is the most important thing. Let's bring it to everyone. That's my opinion. Thanks, everyone, for listening. Thanks to all of our panelists.